in the north woods and deep in the dark pine that blackened the mountains of the Cascade Range. They still tell the tales of an Indian legend. Sasquatch is the legend, Bigfoot is the name. The Indians claim he's the missing link that fits in the gap of the evolution chain. You can make your mind up when you've heard the story. Sasquatch is the story, Bigfoot is the name. You can ride from Canada to Northern California, all up and down the Cascade Range. But if you go alone, friend, I'm here to warn you. Look out for the thing with a Bigfoot name. Look out for the thing with a Bigfoot name.
What's up, everybody? Welcome to a new episode of Weendawg Radio. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in today. I'm so happy with the results of the last episode I did on aliens that I got inspired to continue this little trend of like these sort of like weird episodes where I talk about just random silly stuff like aliens, you know, stuff like that. I decided to do this episode on Sasquatches, or also known as Bigfoot. And, you know, this is very near and dear to my heart. Ever since I was a kid, I have been weirdly obsessed with Bigfoot and Sasquatches, Sasquatches, whatever you want to call them. I don't know what it is. It's the mystery, which is the same reason why we did the alien episode. We want to find out what the hell's going on, what the hell's in the forests of Washington or Oregon or the Deep South. What the hell is this weird-ass creature that is almost impossible to find? The only evidence we have are footprints, fossilized footprints. Well, not really fossilized, but they're like casted footprints, and there's hundreds of those, but how many of those are fake? Next in line we have the cell phone footage of Bigfoot, which, you know, Mitch Hedberg had the hilarious joke that, you know, Bigfoot is blurry because every video of Bigfoot is the worst quality of footage. It's like 2 pixels. All you see in the background is like a little dark shadow move from left to right, and then title of the video is Bigfoot caught on camera 100% real. So I think the internet, all these internet videos have made it just so hard to believe any evidence that comes out now. And, you know, recently there's been a lot of stuff in the Bigfoot world when it comes to DNA with the Sasquatches. They have, I guess, they found hair, and when they took them to the lab to get the hair identified, they have no idea where it came from. It came up that it had no matches. So that's what we got going for us in the Bigfoot community. And let me tell you, out of all the like the cryptozoology type things that I like to talk about, this has to be the most controversial one. Even more than ghosts, even more than aliens, even more than the Loch Ness Monster. Just because, to me, God, it's really silly, to be honest. It's silly to think that there's a big, hairy, ape-like creature running through the forest that no one has ever caught, captured, killed, and there's been no signs of dead bodies anywhere. It's really sketchy, to be honest, but that's what makes it so fun. And nowadays, we're so spoiled by the internet. There's constant videos of Bigfoot coming out that, you know, who knows if they're real. They're probably 99.953.14% fake. You know, until somebody like Les Stroud comes along and tells a crazy Bigfoot story. We've all heard this story. I can't really remember it, but we've heard it before. And, you know, Les Stroud is the Survivor Man guy, and he's very credible, to my knowledge. Very nice dude. You all heard him on the Joe Rogan podcast. And so when someone like that comes out, who spends so much time in the wilderness, someone like that comes out and tells a story like the one he told, it's like, damn, maybe something is out there. And it really gets you thinking. Maybe there's creatures on this earth that have yet to be discovered. And we all know that, especially with the ocean. What, there's only 2% of the world's ocean has been explored or something crazy like that. We haven't really explored the deep, deep, deep sea. We need remote-controlled submarines to do that. I remember James Cameron went down to I don't know if he went to the very bottom of the Mariana Trench, which is like one of the deepest known locations in the sea. It's crazy, son of a bitch, goddamn. So I guess what I'm trying to say is that there's still things that need to be discovered out here in this world. And Bigfoot is on the top of my list. We really need to look at, the way I look at it is there's like a fuse. And right now the fuse has been burning ever since the infamous Gimli Patterson footage. You know, that's the most famous footage of Bigfoot ever. And it came out like in the 70s or something. Ever since that footage, there's been like a boom to find Bigfoot. And now with technology coming out, we have drones, forest cameras, thermal imaging cameras, all this crazy technology. And it's going to just keep advancing. And yet still there's no proof. There's no solid evidence that there is a big hairy creature out there in the woods. So how much technology do we need to find this creature? What else is needed to really get the evidence that we need? What else do we need to find a dead body of Sam Squanch? And that's the fuse. There's gonna come a time where we're going to be able to 100% map, digitally map the entire forest, create a 3D image of the entire forest below and above the trees. We're going to be able to scan every single living creature in those forests. And that's where the fuse ends. Because if we don't find anything that remotely looks like a Sam Squanch, then the case is settled. Then there is no Bigfoot. You know, the people are going to have to, the squatchers are going to have to come to that reality. And that's the fence that I'm leaning on right now. Listen, I would want nothing more in life to have Bigfoot be real. Bigfoot and ghosts, demons, I want all that stuff to be real. Because it makes life more exciting. You know, maybe we aren't at the top of the food chain. Maybe there's a big creature in the forest that will completely kill us, they'll fuck us up easily. And who knows, maybe they are highly intelligent if they've managed to keep away from humans this whole time. And people, you know, there's different accounts saying that Bigfoot, oh, they're harmless creatures, they just want to be left alone. Other accounts say, oh my God, don't even go near a goddamn Bigfoot. They'll kill you, they'll rip you to shreds. But I don't know how many cases there are where random mangled dead bodies of people have been found in the forest where the prime suspect is a Sam Squanch. And you know what? One of the things on my bucket list is to go squatching. Go in the deep, deep forest of, I don't know, Washington. I guess that's the Bigfoot capital of the world, Washington. Get like some hillbilly dude. I don't know how easy it is going to find a hillbilly guy in Washington. But, you know, someone with a deep southern accent, a badass handlebar mustache, decked out all in camo, carrying a 12-gauge shotgun. I want to go with this dude, bring a case of beer, go hike deep into the forest, set up a campsite, camp out there at night, tell Bigfoot stories, listen for any sounds we hear in the distance. That's the life, dude. If I ever make a lot of money, enough to where I can retire early. That's what I'm going to do for the rest of my life, is just go out with people in the woods, look for Bigfoot, have a good time, get wasted, all that stuff. I can't wait, man. Is Bigfoot real? I came across this 911 call. And this is very disturbing to listen to. It comes from a man back in 1990 in Washington. The man, I guess, he was in a cabin, like a log cabin by himself. I'm not sure if it was his home or not, but he was there by himself, and the cabin, you know, was surrounded by woods, by trees, dark, thick forest. I gotta learn the difference between the woods and the forest, goddammit. But it's like, it's the woods, basically. Cabin in the woods. So there is a suspicious creature, person, humanoid being that kept, you know, acting weird, and it was coming up to the cabin, going away, looking through the windows, and the guy was freaking out. And he's like, what the hell is going on with this thing? And he noticed that it was huge. This creature was giant. And he's scared, so he called the police, and this is the 911 call. Listen.
911, what are you reporting?
We got someone or something crawling around out here.
Did you see what it was? Was it a person or an animal or?
I can't tell. All I know is that my central light came on and I just happened to glimpse and see this thing running across the yard. A good sized man or something. It looks like a man. I don't know what it was. Just it ran across the yard.
Okay. You've had problems in the neighborhood before?
Yeah, my dog was killed here just recently. I don't know what it was. Whatever it is, it's running. I couldn't catch it if I was going to chase it. But whatever it was standing up. I'm out here looking through the window now and I don't see anything. I don't want to go outside. Jesus Christ, you better...
Sir?
Deal!
Hello?
Get somebody out here.
What's going on now, sir?
That son of a bitch is about 6'9", I don't know.
Do you see him now, sir?
Yes, I'm looking right at him.
Uh-oh. Okay, hang on.
He's right...
Is he in your yard, sir?
Yeah, God, he's big.
Okay, what's he doing in your yard?
He's looking at me.
Oh, and the guy is on foot.
I don't know what... It's a big... Real big person. That's all I can say.
Okay, but it is a person.
I'd say it was a person, somebody really big. But he's all in black.
Is he a black male or a white male? Did you actually see whether, or was he just wearing black?
He's all black and he's big. He is big.
And that's where the call cuts off. Now, I know you guys are probably sitting there listening to this and you're saying, yo, Weendawg, how dare you play this clip? You know, it was just some black dude trying to rob this house. But I really do not think so. How many black dudes you see in the woods? Exactly. Case closed. So I just want you for a second, if you can, just imagine this and put yourself in this guy's shoes. All right, it's late at night. Let's just say 12:30 at night. You're in your nice log cabin, sitting by the fireplace, reading a book, whatever you're doing. Maybe you're watching YouTube videos. Maybe you're on Weendawg TV. Maybe you're listening to Weendawg Radio, and you're home alone in the nearest cabin or store. Any hint of civilization is miles away. Top, you know, like 5 miles away. We'll just say that. Then all of a sudden you hear something outside. You're like, what the hell is that? Oh, it's probably like a deer or something. Just a little deer. You go up to the window. You look at the window. And all you see is a thick fog of blackness. You see the trees from the woods. All crammed in tight together. It's so dark, you probably can't even see like 20 feet into the forest just because there's so many trees and it's just dark outside. There's no light from the moon shining. The only light is the light from your motion sensor that just turned on. You know, motion sensors, when somebody walks in front of them, the light turns on from the motion sensor, and that's the only source of light outside. You're like, what the hell is going on? Why did my motion sensor turn on? And you look and you focus your sight straight ahead, deep into the woods, and you see a black figure or a dark figure. And it's a big humanoid creature. And you're like, what the hell is that? So you close the blinds, go back inside. No big deal. Then it comes up and looks through the windows. And it's like, what the hell is going on? Then you call the police, and that's what happens. Now, maybe it is just some big-ass person trying to break into this dude's house. Maybe it is a Bigfoot. All I know is if I see something that's close to 7 feet tall in the woods at night, standing on two legs, I'm gonna shit my pants. This is one of the creepiest, like, 911 calls I've ever listened to. For some reason, I have a thing where I like to listen to 911 calls. Not the funny ones. I like to listen to, like, the dark stuff. I've listened to 911 calls from the World Trade Center just moments after the plane hit. People call. They're like, something just happened. We're at the World Trade Center. We heard a loud explosion. And the call that I listened to, it even went until the tower collapsed. The call ends, and all you hear is this person screaming on the other line, and then the phone call just cuts, and it's like, well, Jesus Christ, that's some dark stuff. There's also 911 calls where people are home alone and somebody breaks into their house and they have to hide and they call the police, and then the intruder breaks into their room and attacks them, and it's all recorded on the 911 call. And you can find all of these on YouTube, too. Just type in, like, disturbing 911 calls or something. I don't know why I like to listen to this stuff. It just creeps me out. And I always listen to this stuff and, like, watch these creepy videos at night when I'm trying to go to bed. So I have just crazy nightmares all night. It's tremendous. All right, let's get back to Bigfoot. I wish there's people who had, like, Bigfoot stories as much as there were people who had ghost stories. Because almost everybody has a goddamn ghost story. But not too many have a Bigfoot story. You ever notice that? Another crazy Bigfoot story comes from this guy named Mike Woolley. And back when I said on this podcast that I would love to go deep into the woods with, like, a hillbilly dude, like a southern guy who knows everything about the outdoors, everything about guns, everything about hunting. This is the dude I'm talking about. And he has this crazy story. So listen to it and then, you know, tweet me on Twitter what you think about this. Email me. Here it is, Mike Woolley's Bigfoot story.
My name is Mike Woolley. I'm from Keachaw, Louisiana. I had an encounter back in December of 1981 with a Bigfoot while deer hunting. It was a beautiful December day, perfect weather for a hunt. Temperature was about 30 degrees. I got to my deer stand that evening, about 3 o'clock, got on it. And I was sitting there and I was facing to the north. And my deer stand was located about a mile and a half down an old logging road and off the main highway, secondary highway. And what I would do, I would park my truck halfway down the logging road and I would walk in the rest of the way because I didn't want to drive my truck down and spook the deer. Well, it must have been, I hadn't been there no more than 30 minutes. And this little young doe deer come running from the east out of some briars and brush that there's no way a human could walk through that. But she come up to my deer stand, and what was so amusing, come up to my deer stand and laid down, up and actually touching the deer stand. She was wringing wet was wet. She had been run. Something had been running her. And the first thing hit my mind, it was a big buck. And I said, I'm going to kill me a big buck. So when I raised my head back up, I was turning my head, and out of my peripheral vision, I seen something hop to a tree. And it was tall, about 7-8 foot tall, and it was black, real hairy, like a gorilla. And I knew it wasn't a gorilla because there was no circus in town, and I knew it hadn't escaped, and I knew we didn't have no gorillas running loose. So the first thing hit my mind, it was somebody dressed up in a suit trying to scare me off my good deer hunting spot. Well, I immediately go to talking to this thing, telling it, you know, take the head off, get out of here, you know, don't come back, you know, this ain't no joke, I don't find it funny, you know, just leave. Well, this thing was just eyeballing me, you know, looking at me and really giving me some sinister looks. And I knew right then, I said, you know, something ain't right. Well, this went on for a few minutes, and he must have been about 20 yards from me, 15, 20 yards. So I take my rifle, I've got a high-powered rifle with a high-powered scope on the rifle, and I look through the scope at the creature. And I knew that after looking at it, I was in a situation because it was cold, you know, the moisture was coming out of its mouth, its nostrils. It looked really, really human. The face was human. The eyelashes, I could see the eyelashes, you know, the eyes, the teeth were big, big teeth, flat teeth like our teeth. So anyway, I'm sitting there and I'm looking at it, and it just, it's really PO'd at me. And it lets out a roar like a lion. Well, about 100 yards to the northeast, there's this really, really loud whistle comes back, you know, a signal to the growl. Well, this creature looks over that way and whistles back in the same tone of whistle, and then turns and looks at me. Well, I'm kind of like, hey, you know, what's going on here? You know, something's up. I'm in trouble, big trouble. Well, all of a sudden I hear movement coming from that direction, and I knew whatever he signaled was coming to meet up with him. And I knew that I was probably going to be the one going to be on the losing end of the stick, you know. Well, I thought it was a feral human because I'd heard about them, you know, done some reading about them. But so far as a Bigfoot, I thought that was something that existed out in California. I just thought that was something somebody made up to make money off of. Well, I jumped down off my stand, and I'm running to the west to get to my truck. And I look over my left shoulder, and this creature is running through the woods, and it is just moving brush. It's running through the brush, and it's bulldozing the brush down. And I knew, man, this thing is going to get me. It is mad. It is PO'd. It's going to get me. Well, I'm coming up on my truck, and I'm thinking, well, I got to stop to unlock my truck. And when I get ready to unlock the truck, he's going to make his move. He's going to have me. Well, something crossed my mind to fire a warning shot. Well, when I got to the tailgate of the truck, I threw my rifle to the left, pulled the trigger, and the shot fired, and the bullet hit about 7 foot up in a tree and blew bark in front of his face. The bark actually hit him in the face because he was about 3 foot from the tree. If the creature would have been another 2 seconds, the bullet would have hit him dead in the head. Well, I got in a truck, I'm driving off, I look in my rearview mirror, and lo and behold, his buddy that he'd signaled had been tailing me coming up the logging road. I didn't have but one chasing me, I had two. Well, they kind of stood there and looked at each other as I was driving off. But my recommendation to anybody, if you ever have an encounter in the woods, is don't fool with them, don't make eye contact, don't point, and surely don't point a gun. Do not engage this creature, because if you do, you will lose. The reason I didn't shoot it is it was just too human. The face, it was a bipedal, you know, it walked on two legs, just like we did. But it was just too human. The face was too human, the eyelashes, the teeth, the jaw structure, the forehead, it was light brown. The face was light brown, like it had a dark suntan. But I couldn't pull the trigger because something told me this ain't right. It's not the right thing to do.
So what would happen if you're out hunting and a big, large creature covered in hair with a human face came up to you in a sinister way, you unknowing its intentions? Would you have the guts to shoot it and kill it, try to kill it? The reason this man didn't kill it is because it seemed too human. Maybe something deep down inside suggested that it was human, but we'll never know because we weren't there. And that is what, ladies and gentlemen, intrigues me so much about this stuff, whether it's Bigfoot, aliens, whatever. These personal accounts of these stories, they're endless, and it's hard to believe in something when most of the evidence is just from personal accounts. And that's why in the law enforcement world, when somebody is a witness, you never know if they're going to be telling the truth or how accurate the truth is. Because in times of distress and panic, not every detail of the scene is implanted in your brain, but it's the key details, like the face of the creature, the height of the creature, that seems to terrify one into implanting those descriptions into their mind. And being able to tell these stories to the rest of the world, it really is mysterious. I really do hope someday I will come in contact with a Bigfoot. I don't know what I'll say to him. Maybe I'll be relieved that there is more to life than what meets the eye. Don't believe anything anybody tells you. We all have those people in our lives that make fun of us for believing in Bigfoot or believing in ghosts or believing in some higher power, whether it's aliens or a god. It's like a big, hairy slap in the face to those people. But who knows? Hopefully we'll find the answer within our lifetimes. Ladies and gentlemen, this has been a very curious episode of Weendawg Radio. It's a little bit of a shorter episode. I do have some people that I want to talk to in person about stuff like this. But right now I'm doing like a testing stage with this podcast. Like I want to see if you guys prefer episodes like this episode and the one before that one, where I talked about ghosts and then aliens, and I had clips from the internet. I played EVPs for you guys. I played Carl Sagan. It's a little bit of a more produced and edited version of the podcast rather than just straight talking for whatever, for like an hour maybe. It's a little bit different than that. And I like this version. One of the podcasts that inspired me the most was Radiolab, or is Radiolab. How it's like a show, like a straight up show. They have sound effects, music, and they actually travel the world just for a single episode of their podcast. Their latest podcast is about, I'm only halfway through it, but so far it's about raccoons and watermelons and stuff like that. I just love how they can find like little stories and like investigate them. I don't know. If you haven't listened to Radiolab, please do. It's amazing. Probably one of the best podcasts. So they inspired me to, you know, put some more work into these episodes, put some creepy background music or whatever it may be, clips from the internet, interviews, and stuff like that. And I'm also uploading these episodes now to YouTube, where on my YouTube channel, Weendawg TV, and I'm putting like a slideshow of like pictures along with the podcast that go like in sync with what the podcast is talking about or what I'm talking about on the podcast. So you can go check it out right now if you're not already listening to this on YouTube. Well, if you are, thank you very much. Once again, the channel is Weendawg TV. Subscribe to that, and I'll put this podcast up on YouTube and iTunes, all that fun stuff. So go ahead, subscribe to Weendawg TV. I would really appreciate it. See, right now I'm working on my own personal holy trinity of things. What I mean by that is I'm working on three things that will help me for the future of my career, whatever it may be. So at the top, we have stand-up comedy. I want to try to get up at least 3 times a week on stage. And some say that's still not enough. But as long as I'm consistently doing it, I'll find myself getting better and better. And that I am. I am getting better with stand-up. Slowly but surely, I'm getting more confidence when I'm on stage. And that's such a big, big aspect of comedy is confidence. If you go to any open mics, you'll see people up there, they're very shy and nervous, and it doesn't really come off good when you're in front of a crowd. So that's at the top of the Trinity triangle of Weendawg. Up next, we have podcasting, which is what I'm doing right now. If I'm consistent with this podcast, then I will be ever growing. And listeners and support, people who listen, people who contact me on Twitter and say that they listen, all that is letting me know that I'm doing something right. And I really want feedback from you guys. I want you guys to tell me what you want with this podcast, what you want me to talk about. Just tweet me any subjects, anything. I'll cover it on this podcast. And I love podcasting. I really do hope I'll have more podcasts in the future. I want to do this podcast as long as I possibly can. The possibilities are endless when it comes to podcasting. I'm actually going to take a podcasting class in school this semester, so I'm kind of interested in that. I don't know how goofy it's going to be. I mean, I've been doing podcasts for a few years now, and I've been listening to podcasts for like, I don't know, 6-7 years, a long ass time. Up next, we have the YouTube channel, Weendawg TV. And I really would like to grow this channel. I love making dumb videos, whether I'm playing video games or just posting anything, a clip of me talking in my webcam. I love doing all that stuff. And there was a period where I stopped uploading for a couple months. But now I'm doing it. If I can do one video a week, then I'll be happy. I just did a top 5 photos with creepy and mysterious background video. Backstories. So it was 5 pictures that I found with creepy stories behind them, basically. I don't know. It's actually a pretty decent video. It took me a long time to make it. So check that out on my YouTube channel, Weendawg TV. Tell me what you think, and I'll make more videos like that. If you want me to do like a top 5 something, let me know. Top 5 whatever. Ow. Your foot. So I'm definitely going to continue making those kind of videos. I love like the list of videos where it's top whatever, top Weendawg podcasts, top Weendawg stories, top ghost videos, top 5, whatever. So if you like that kind of stuff, then my channel is for you. And I did the Resident Evil 7 gameplay. That was fun. It took me like 10 hours to beat that game, but it's no big deal. Got some upcoming games coming out in the future, too, that I'm going to play. You know, we've got Outlast 2. God damn, I look forward to that game. So I just want to keep uploading to YouTube, and hopefully we'll see growth, and we're going to grow together, and I know we are. I have faith in you guys. I have faith in the YouTube channel. I have faith in this podcast. I have faith in my stand-up. But there's one thing. Let's say we have this Trinity, and there's something that's not a part of it, but I do wish to get better at, and that is jiu-jitsu. And I have a lot of people that listen to this podcast, and they listen to the MMA Roasted podcast, and they subscribe to Weendawg TV, and I know they do Brazilian jiu-jitsu. And I've been doing it for about, I really don't even know anymore, like 2 years or so, maybe a little bit over 2 years. I started with a gi, and I didn't really go that often as I should have. I probably went like maybe 2 to 3 times a week. And I didn't really grow that much. The most experience I ever got was learning the, you know, just the basic fundamentals of jiu-jitsu. How to pass the guard, what to do when you're in side control. Just the basic stuff. I didn't really learn a lot of submissions. And I just learned triangle, Americana, armbar, and that's like pretty much it. But ever since I've been going to 10th Planet Burbank, I feel like I'm learning so much more. I'm getting a lot better, and I can see it in my rolling on the mat during mat time. I'm going literally every single day to jiu-jitsu except Friday because there's no classes Friday, and not really Saturday because I'm never really here Saturdays, but I'm going to the open mat on Sundays, and God damn it, I love it. Listen, I'm still getting my ass whooped. At 10th Planet, there's like, everybody is so good. I don't understand. I'm like the worst one in the whole gym. I get owned by every single person, but you either win or you learn. Was that the words of Conor McGregor? You win or you learn? Or John Kavanaugh, whatever one said that? You win and you learn, and that's what I'm doing. Every time I get thrown through the air, landing on my back, and then someone jumping on top of me, breaking my arm, every time that happens, I learn something. I learn how to pass the guard a little bit better. I learn how to maintain mount a little better. I learn how to not really pull guard when you start and not let them just get on top of you instantly. But there's one thing that's really been bothering Leighton with jiu-jitsu, and it's making me feel bad about myself, and that is that, you see, me, I'm a large person. I'm a very big-ass dude. I'm 6'2", probably like 225 pounds, and everybody at 10th Planet is very, like, I'm not going to say skinny. A lot of people are in really good shape there, but they're... Let's just say I'm the fattest person there, all right? And when I'm rolling with people smaller than me, I'm trying to teach myself to be careful and not use my weight and my height and my size as the main advantage. I don't want to go in there and just muscle people down because I feel like I'm not really using any technique. I'm just, you know, manhandling people, and that's not what I like to do. It costs too much energy. I gas out fast, and I notice that when I'm doing that, people get hurt a lot when I roll with them. And I'm not the kind of person that holds submissions after they already tapped out. I'm not the kind of person that's looking to hurt people, but I've noticed a lot of people will get injured with me just because of, you know, like mainly... I guess my size, to be honest. I don't know. I don't know what it is. A lot of the times, well, basically, you know, 100% of the time, it's never on purpose. I'm not hurting people on purpose. It's all an accident. You know, you'll be rolling and the pace picks up and you accidentally slap somebody in the face. That happens almost every single time I'm rolling with somebody. Either I'm getting slapped in the face or they're getting slapped. They take a knee to the face. I take a knee to the face. You know, that's just basic stuff in jiu-jitsu. And I think maybe I'm thinking about it too much. I know it keeps me up at night. I feel so bad if I'm rolling with somebody and I get him in like an Americana, and they tap and they're like, God damn it, my arm. Which is, I guess, you know, is the Americana is my favorite submission just because it's the easiest one for me to get. If you don't know what the Americana is, it's basically if you were to put one of your arms, like you're flexing your bicep, you put it up next to your head, and then somebody's going to grab it and just bend it back towards your back, like bend it backwards. And that's basically what the Americana is. And the Kimura is like the opposite, where it's down and you bend it back. So for me, that's the easiest submission to get, because I like to pin their arm down from side control or mount and then just, you know, get the Americana. But it's a tricky move, because if you're going for it, about 90% of the time, people are going to try to defend it. And when you defend it, you got to, you know, use your strength to not let them torque your arm in that direction. And I know there's way better ways of defending against the Americana that, you know, I'm only a white belt, I don't know. So it's like a battle of strength at this point. And this is where it gets dangerous. So I'll be fighting with somebody. I get the Americana lock, the key lock, and I'm working for that Americana, and they're trying to defend. And then sometimes, you know, I'm stronger than the other person and I get it, and then they got to tap out. So in my head, I'm expecting the person to defend like that every single time. So sometimes I'll get in side control, I'll get in mount, whichever one, doesn't matter, and I'll go for the Americana, and then I'll expect them to resist. So I use my strength, and then for some reason they're not resisting at all. And then I just maybe get it too fast and it hurts them a little bit. I don't know. But that's my problem. That's happened to me one time, I think. I don't do that every class, but even if it happens to me one time where maybe somebody gets hurt from an Americana or any submission, I feel so bad. It like eats me up inside. I guess the one time I did it, this was back when I was doing gi jiu-jitsu. I had a guy in, I don't know, side control, and I went for the Americana. And he didn't resist it at all. I just took his arm. It was like rolling with like a four-year-old. Not that I'm saying he's bad. I'm saying that he just didn't resist the submission. Like he didn't use his strength at all to stop me from completing the submission. So I guess I just bent it back a little too fast and it hurt his arm. But it's no big deal. It just tweaked his elbow, I guess. Dog, let me tell you, I felt so bad. I was like, I almost just wanted to like, I don't know. I felt like buying him like an Amazon gift card because I felt so bad. I was like, dude, I suck. And then on Sunday at open mat, we were doing some drills. Just practicing with my buddy, my new buddy at 10th Planet. I got his back. Got the lockdown. And I went for the twister. Got the twister. But I guess he hurt his lip, or he bit his lip, or his sharp canine tooth sort of stabbed his cheek, I guess. It wasn't nothing too bad, but I can tell that it bothered him. It hurt him a little bit. And I felt so bad again. Even though he wasn't wearing a mouth guard, I wasn't wearing a mouth guard because we weren't really rolling. We're just doing drills. Dude, I don't know why. I just feel so bad. I feel like people just keep getting hurt when I roll with them. So I'm really starting to slow it down and just focus on my technique. And that's pretty much it. I mean, I get hurt every single class. You heard Frank Trigg on the podcast, on the MMA Roasted podcast, asking why I have so many goddamn bruises all over my arms. That's what my whole body looks like. So hopefully I'll learn the technique so I don't have to hurt people. And I'm really trying to cut my weight down. I want to do a competition. I want to do a tournament. I know I'll get my ass whooped in a tournament, but it's no big deal. I want to do it. I just got to get down to a reasonable weight. I'm tired of wearing a goddamn t-shirt over my rash guard because I'm so embarrassed of my rolls hanging out. It's listen, when I'm just wearing a straight rash guard, nothing over, it's terrible. It looks disgusting. So I wear a t-shirt over my rash guard. And I really want to get down to the weight where I don't have to wear a t-shirt, because it's very uncomfortable wearing a t-shirt in jiu-jitsu. You know, it always gets caught on somebody's knee. It gets really wet and sweaty, and it gets heavy, and it stretches out, it tears, and it's like, God damn it, why am I so fat? So I went on a run last night. I ran like 4 miles, trying to eat better, eating healthy. So hopefully within a few months I'll get down to that weight. Probably not, but it's no big deal. I know there's a bunch of jiu-jitsu savages out there that listen to this podcast. If you have any tips for me, I'd love it. Email me at weendawgtv@gmail.com or just tweet me on Twitter. Follow me on Instagram, Joe P. Comedy. Twitter, Joe P. Comedy. I really love all you guys. Thanks for listening. This has been a quick little episode about Bigfoot. No big deal. Talk a little bit about jiu-jitsu, Trinity of Weendawg. That's pretty much it. And if you're in the Los Angeles area, want to come see some comedy? March 30th at Flappers is going to be my birthday show. It's not going to be like a big celebration. It's just going to be a regular show, but we're going to have a bunch of savages there. We might... There's a possibility we're going to have Uncle Joey come by. You never know with Joey. You can book him for something, but you don't know if he's going to show up or not because he's a very busy man. So there's a possibility we're going to have Uncle Joey, maybe Adam Hunter, maybe Lee Syatt. It's going to be a great show celebrating my 21st birthday. I'm not the kind of guy that likes like birthday celebrations like this, but it's a big deal. All right, 21st. Could finally drink goddamn alcohol. I've been waiting my whole life to drink alcohol. But it's no big deal, right? Wink, wink, wink. Anyways, that's my podcast. Thank you. Subscribe to Weendawg TV on YouTube. And you know what to do. Thank you guys for listening. This is Weendawg. Have a good day. Bye-bye. They still tell the tales of an Indian legend. Sasquatch is the legend. Bigfoot is the name. The Indians claim he's the missing link that fits in the gap of the evolution chain. You can make your mind up when you've heard the story. Sasquatch is the story. Bigfoot is the name. You can ride from Canada to Northern California, all up and down the Cascade Range. But if you go alone, friend, I'm here to warn you. Look out for the thing with a Bigfoot name. Look out for the thing with a Bigfoot name. From out of the Yakima Indian Reservation, a young cowboy and an Indian came to hunt in the mountains of Northern California. Proof was the purpose, Bigfoot was the game. Now young Roger Patterson ran a small string of horses, and he lived in the foothills in a cabin with his wife. He knew that many secrets were hidden in these mountains, and he had heard the legend of Bigfoot for most all his life. You can ride from Canada to Northern California, all up and down the Cascade Range. But if you go alone, friend, I'm here to warn you. Look out for the thing with a Bigfoot name. Look out for the thing with a Bigfoot name. 9 years ago, while running wild horses, deep in the mountains with an old Indian friend, he ran across a huge, very huge footprint, and this is where the hunt for the Bigfoot man began. To town and back they went, and they made a plaster cast, 18 inches long from heel to the toe. And from the print that it made, they guessed that it must have weighed 700 pounds or so. You can ride.
ride from Canada to Northern California, all up and down the Cascade Range. But if you go alone, friend, I'm here to warn you. Look out for the thing with a Bigfoot name. Look out for the thing with a Bigfoot name. Now the facts they put together sent chills right up their spines, and the search for a lot more information began. And when they told the story and showed these plaster prints, they only grew laughs from strangers as well as friends. Now up through the years, they found a lot more footprints, and they gathered sworn statements from a lot of decent-minded folks. But when they took these facts up to the educated experts, it was all disregarded and branded as a hoax. You can ride from Canada to Northern California, all up and down the Cascade Range. But if you go alone, friend, I'm here to warn you. Look out for the thing with a Bigfoot name. Look out for the thing with a Bigfoot name. It become a challenge to Roger and the Indian to gather more proof and to bring it all forth and show the whole wide world that this Bigfoot man is alive today and living in the mountains to the north. And for years they gathered a lot of signed statements and tapes from people who had seen Bigfoot or his tracks. But still no sightings and no filmed photographs, and they knew they must bring a lot better proof back. You can ride from Canada to Northern California, all up and down the Cascade Range. But if you go alone, friend, I'm here to warn you. Look out for the thing with a Bigfoot name. Look out for the thing with a Bigfoot name.